parabolic mirrors. So this is a particular shape, parabola shape, and these are used to focus signals. So they can be used in satellite dishes. That's why they have this shape, it's a parabola. You can use them in listening devices to focus a weak sound signal. It's used in espionage and then amplify the signal that you're getting. It's used in torches, spotlights to focus the beam. Really cool stuff. And we're going to go through the maths of it, the geometry, to see how that focusing works. Like, why does it have to be a parabola shape to get this focusing behavior? All right, so big parabola, something like that. So let's say this is X, this is Y, and my parabola here is going to be, ooh, I've drawn it this way, so it's Y squared equals 4AX is the equation. So you might be used to it being Y equals X squared would be that way up because I've rotated it. So let's now take a point in our parabola. Let's call this point P, and this is going to be a distance X on the x-axis. This is going to be at the position A times T squared. Now, A is important because A here is controlling how steep the parabola is. So as we make A bigger, these sort of become steeper, closer, and as we make A smaller, these become narrower. So A just controls the shape, so we're covering all possible parabolas by including it. Of course, we could just set it to 1, but let's be general. And then T, as we increase and decrease T, we slide up and down the x-axis. Now, if this is at x equals a t squared, then we can work out the y value of this. So if y squared is 4ax, then I think that's going to mean that y can be plus or minus 2at, and there's going to be a minus 2at down here. We're going to focus on the plus point. So they're the two points on the parabola when x is this, satisfying that equation. Now, how a parabolic mirror works is you have light sound coming in, and the parabolic shape acts to focus it onto a single point. So that's how you get your TV signal. You have all these bits of the signal, they get focused, give you a nice strong signal. Same for listening devices, torches, whatever it might be. You can even use them to collect sunlight and create a little bit of heat, a bit of fire if you're in the desert, for example. I am gonna claim that this is going to go to a point on the x-axis, A0. So a distance of A inside parabola. And again, remember, A just controls the shape. So obviously this will move as the shape changes, as you would expect, but it's definitely at y value 0, so it's on the x-axis. So if we're going to argue that this is the case, then what this is going to mean is we're going to have a wave, light wave, sound wave, coming in horizontally, and we need it to bounce like this. Now, we could have another one, say it was here, like this, coming in horizontally, hitting here, and I'm claiming it's going to bounce to that same point. That's what we want. That's the whole purpose of the parabolic mirror. All these horizontal beams coming in, bouncing off that, and they all converge at the same point, amplifies your signal, gives you your heat, your light, your sound, whatever you want.
So that's like where you'd put maybe your sensor or your receiver.
Exactly, or that. That's where your sensor, or your bulb in a torch. So, because for a torch, it bounces out this way, and then you get a nice, perfect horizontal beam. So if you have a torch, you get like a focused beam.
Oh, imagine what that might look like.
It's quite a focused beam, okay? It sort of expands a little bit, but it's relatively focused compared to like the light on the ceiling, or, you know, a studio light that we have over here. The light just kind of goes everywhere. It's not in a focused beam because the studio light is just a load of bulbs putting in all directions. Here, what we're doing is the bulb is pinging everything, so it comes out in this focused beam. It's how spotlights work.
Where's the parabola there?
So the parabola is going to be inside, a bit just inside there. Quite hard to tell it's exactly a parabola, but if you measured it, I can guarantee you it would be. It's having the same effect.
Okay.
So if we're going to show how this works mathematically, we need to do some geometry, because what we know from physics, and we do this all the time as mathematicians, we borrow from laws of physics. We know that the light coming in, the angle here, and this is an angle with the tangent to the parabola, right? So we draw the gradient of the parabola there, put its tangent in. We know the angle there is the angle there, because it comes in and reflects at the same angle. It might not look like it on my diagram. This is a sketch. So what we need to do, or we need to show mathematically, is that this angle here and this angle are the same. Because if we can show that, if we can show the angle coming in, the angle coming out, based on going from a general point always to here, that would prove from a mathematical standpoint that everything is going to be focused at this point.
That same theta applies.
Yes, yeah. Exactly, okay. Exactly. So the angle will change. This theta will be different to the theta up here. But the key thing is, in both situations, so let's call that one theta 1, and let's call this one theta 2. So in both situations, we know it has to come in and go out at the same angle. That's the law of physics we have to follow. But the key thing is, it's coming in at a certain angle, bouncing out at the same one, going to the focus, our amplifier. This one comes in at a different angle, bounces out at the same different angle, but again, it ends up at the same point. And if I had another one here, it would come in, bounce out. Every time, no matter what angle it comes in at, it goes out at the same one, but always into the same point.
Is this only for beams that are coming in at a straight line?
This is only beams that come in horizontally, yes. So it is just for horizontal beams coming in. Now, of course, there's going to be some error. There's some, you know, I don't know what to call it, noise in some of these signals. But this is the sort of theory behind the parabolic shape. It's only the parabola that will focus to this point. And that's what we're going to show.
And if your target's very far away, like a star or something in space, for all intents and purposes, they all are coming in at the same straight line.
Exactly, yeah. Yes. So this is, it also is used in telescopes. Exactly for that. Because stars, they're so far away, you need to amplify the light that's coming in, so you have to focus it all into the same point. So you use, again, parabolic mirrors to do that. So the way we do this is going to be using vectors. We want to describe our positions. So this is the focus, our point P. We want to be able to describe these with vectors and construct an equation to argue why these two angles are the same. So to start with, we're going to assume they're not the same. We're going to work out this one, so let's call this theta 2 hat, and this one theta 2, just to be clear. But we're going to end up showing that theta 2 hat is theta 2, where specifically one of them is the horizontal coming in and one of them is going to the focus. And the key aspect to this is, remember, I introduced this parameter t, which meant there was nothing special about the point I picked. Because as I vary t, the whole problem just moves around. So that's where we get the generality, and that's why we are ultimately showing how these things work. First of all, we need to know the tangent to the curve up here. We fortunately have an equation. We know that y squared is equal to 4ax. We want to know the gradient at p. So the gradient at that point is found by differentiating our function dy by dx. So we know the coordinates of p as well, don't we? We know that's at squared and y is 2at. So we have to do implicit differentiation, which tells us 2y dy by dx equals 4a. So that's just differentiating both sides with respect to x. And then we rearrange that. So that tells us that dy by dx is 4a over 2y. We want to know it at this point where this is x and this is y. So we sub in that y value into here. So we can say the gradient dy by dx at the point P is 4a over 2 times the y value there, which is 2at. 4a over 4at, it's 1 over t. So the first thing to check is that sensible? As I change t, my gradient here changes. So this is our gradient at this point. Now as I decrease t, I'm moving closer and become steeper. Right here it's vertical. So when t is naught, I've got 1 over 0, that's tending to infinity, which is a vertical gradient. So we see that the gradient actually gets steeper as we move in this way, and it's going to get flatter as I move out here. So it does make sense that it would come out like this. But it's good that t is in there, because we want this to be general for any point in the diagram. So now we've got the gradient at the point P. We now want to work out, well, what is this direction vector here between this line and this? So we're trying to get theta 2. So we want the vector from P to our focus, which is A0. So a vector between those two points is just the vector here minus the value here. Doesn't matter whether we're going out or in, we just need something in that direction. So the vector from P to that point is simply just P minus that. So that's P, subtract that. So that vector will be, let's call it L. So we can say L is going to be the x value, AT squared minus A, that one minus that one, and then that y value minus that one. So this is a vector, x component, y component, which describes this direction here. Now, we need a vector to describe the direction of our tangent. So let's call that t. So the tangent vector, t, we know dy by dx is 1 over t. This is the change in y over the change in x. So this tells you that every time x changes by t, y changes by 1. That's what a gradient means, basically. So if we put every time x changes by t, y changes by 1. So our tangent vector is given by this. T and 1 corresponds to this particular gradient up here. So what we've now got is we know the direction here and we know the direction here as vectors. So if we take the dot product of those two vectors, gives us the angle.
Yeah.
I'm just looking, you're nodding like, okay, if you say so, Tom. Okay, so let's do that. So if we do L dot T, then by definition, the dot product is the length of your first vector times the length of your second vector times cos of the angle between them. So that'll be theta 2, because these are our two vectors, angle between them there is theta 2. It could, of course, be the same one up here, but it doesn't matter for our purposes. Yeah. It's the same angle. Right, so we need to sub these in. Right, so L dot T is the size of L. So when you work out the size of a vector, you square each term, add them together, and then square root. So the size of L is this first one squared, A T squared minus A squared, plus second one squared, 4A squared T squared. So that is the size of L. Size of T, a bit easier, thankfully. It's the square root of the first one squared plus the second one squared, and then we've got cos of theta 2. Now, of course, we can do the dot product. We've got vectors, so you do the first components multiplied together, added to the second two multiplied together. So that tells us that one times that one. So AT cubed minus AT plus that one times that one plus 2AT equals the two square roots times cos theta 2. Because what we want is cos theta 2. So if I rearrange, cos theta 2 is equal to this thing. We've got a minus AT plus 2AT. So that gives me an AT cubed plus AT on the top. And then we've got these things on the bottom. Now, I'm going to simplify it a little bit up here. So if we expand out the square, a squared t to the 4 minus two lots of the cross term, so minus 2 a squared t squared plus a squared, and then plus 4 a squared t squared. So we've got minus 2 lots of it plus 4 lots of it, so that becomes a plus 2. So we've got a squared brackets t to the 4 plus 2 t squared plus 1 in that first bracket. And then we've got second bracket, t squared plus 1. Now this, in here, this is t squared plus 1 squared. Expand that out, t to the fourth plus 2 cross terms plus 1. So that's that. So you've got an a squared times something else squared, we lose the square root. So what we finally end up with is cos theta 2 is, we've got an a factor here as well, an at factor at the top. At times t squared plus 1. Divided by square root of this, so it gives us a times t squared plus 1 times the square root t squared plus 1. And now everything cancels, which is lovely. Cancels, 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 cancels. And we're left with t over the square root t squared plus 1. So we have a formula for cos of theta 2,
yep,
this angle. What we now need to show is that we get the same formula for theta 2 hat, and then we figured it out.
Okay.
Yeah, another piece of paper. To work out cos of theta 2 hat here, same approach, let's figure out the vectors coming in. So we've got t is one vector, and the other one is a horizontal vector here, h, and we want the angle between the two of them. So we want the dot product between t and h. So we know what t is, we figured that one out to be t1. H is a horizontal vector, so that means x changes and y doesn't, so it's just 1, 0, it's your basis vector. So when we take the dot product, t dot h is equal to that one times that one. T plus 1 times 0 is 0. Add them together. That is then equal to the size of t times the size of h times cos of the angle between them, which is that one, theta 2 hat. So we've got t is equal to the size of this, square root of 1 plus t squared. Size of h, well, that's size 1, times cos of theta 2 hat. So we rearrange and say, so cos of theta 2 hat is t over square root of 1 plus t squared. But what did we get? Cos of theta 2 was t over the square root of 1 plus t squared. So that allows us to conclude this is the same as cos of theta 2. So we can take our cos of both sides. So in other words, theta 2 is theta 2 hat, which is exactly what we wanted. So rather than just taking my word for the terrible sketch, we've been able to show mathematically, using vectors, using geometry, the angle coming in is the same as the angle going out, where we're coming in horizontal and we always bounce to the focus. Because there was nothing special about the point P. I could just change the value of T and go here. The whole working out works. So we've actually shown that any horizontal ray coming in and hitting our parabolic mirror will always go to that central point because these two angles are always the same. And light reflection or sound wave reflection means the angle in needs to be the angle out. So that's how parabolic mirrors work.
Lovely.
This episode of Numberphile was brought to you by Jane Street, a research-based trading firm with offices all across the globe. Go to their website and learn about the jobs and internships they have on offer. If you're good with numbers or computers, this could be the start of something very special. But check here, they also have fantastic programs previewing the sort of stuff they do. two current opportunities are these, Insight and the WISE programs. They're targeted at opportunities for women, transgender and gender expansive people. There are lectures, games, mock trading sessions, all sorts of hijinks. Get your applications in now. No matter who you are, Jane Street have got something of interest to you. Go to their website, see what's available. I'll put a link in the video description.